Hi, and welcome to this Christmas Portrait Special Edition episode of the Carpenters Q&A. I'm Chris May. And just as the title suggests, I want to talk about Christmas today. I meant to put this out last December, and time got away from me, as it does for a lot of us. And so I thought, well, what better time to talk about Christmas than in the dead of summer? Some subject matter to cool us off a little bit. So anyway, I'm going to jump in. And for those that don't know me or aren't familiar with my involvement with the Carpenters, I am a Carpenters historian, a longtime historian. And Mike Cidoni, Lennox, myself, and Richard Carpenter wrote and published the exhaustive Carpenters musical biography called The Musical Legacy. It's right behind me. In late 2021. And so if you don't have a copy, I suggest you you pick one up. You can buy it online at Amazon or Barnes & Noble. Any of the brick and mortar stores carry it as well. But it's a great read, and it really dives deep into the musical side of our favorite duo. So anyway, check that out. But I'm going to go ahead and I want to cover a little bit of everything related to the Carpenters' Christmas catalog. And you know, we'll get into the conception of the Christmas Portrait album in 78, the tie-in with the television specials with ABC, talk a little bit about Karen's appearance on the Bruce Forsyth show in the UK, Christmas of 78, Mom and Dad Carpenter making a cameo appearance on the second Christmas special. We'll get into a little bit of all of that. I'm going to start with this first question, which takes us back to 1970. It's really where it all started. This person writes, knowing that Richard wrote his music for Merry Christmas, Darling in 1966, I've always wondered how different that version is compared with the 1970 recording. And did they perform it live during their gigs with Spectrum, or perhaps just as a trio? For those of you that don't have the backstory on Merry Christmas, Darling, it was a song that was written by Karen and Richard's choral instructor at Cal State Long Beach in California. His name is a gentleman by the name of Frank Pooler. Frank wrote the song in 1946. It was about a girlfriend, and he liked the lyric, but he never really cared much for the melody. And so, you know, fast forward 20 years, Richard comes along, and Frank sees his songwriting and arranging abilities, and so he asked him if he wouldn't mind putting a melody to some lyrics that he was going to give him. And so Richard agreed. And on a lunch break, went into a practice room and came up with a melody in about 10 minutes. And so that's how we came to, you know, to get the Merry Christmas, Darling as a song. So to answer your question, yes, Spectrum did, they did perform it live whenever Karen could get into a gig, because she was underage, so she couldn't go into the clubs and that, but whenever they played a casual and she could come along and sing, they did actually perform it, Richard says, a few times. The arrangement was a very sort of skeletal version of what we've come to know as, you know, the completed version recorded in 1970. Because they weren't recording albums and that kind of thing yet, and it wasn't a studio recording, of course, Richard wasn't thinking about strings and all of that. He came up with the idea to release it as a single in 1970 when they were driving from one gig to another, and the song popped into his head, and he realized it was, you know, getting to be that time of year. You know, maybe that would be a good song to consider putting out as a single. And so he finished the arrangement, strings. They went in the same day in November to track For All We Know. They tracked the basic rhythm tracks for Merry Christmas, Darling. And then within 5 days, the orchestration was laid down, all the vocal overdubbing, and it was mixed and it was out. So, but the only thing that they, if you listen to the master, if you listen to the recording, it gets all the way to the end. Karen sings, I wish I were with you, and she holds that. The track, the accompaniment stops on that, I think it's a D, yeah, it's a D major. It's a five chord. It doesn't resolve. She sings the note, and that's all they recorded. That was all that was originally on the recording. And he said, we've got to do something else. There's got to be a better ending. And that's when he came up with the Merry, Merry, Merry Christmas, Darling, the big vocal ending that we have all grown incredibly familiar with. And so that's more or less in a nutshell how that song came to be. Second question is, I was wondering, this person writes, I was wondering, does Richard ever plan to release another Carpenters album of Christmas music, such as the music from their specials, or any unreleased work leads Karen might have left behind? Or has he ever thought about remastering the Christmas Portrait album in a similar fashion as the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra album? Again, I mentioned that Richard, Mike, and I put out the book in 2021. One of the promotional pieces that we did, we was involved in an appearance on a show called Talk Shop Live. It was a on-camera, 90-minute interview. It was the three of us just talking about the book, the writing of the book. And in that interview, and if you want to watch it, it's on my channel here. You can search for it. But Richard talks about this. This is a project, to answer your question, yes. Richard started working on this back in, I think, around 2019 or 2020. And of course, COVID, you know, slowed things down, actually brought him to a halt. But the idea is that his plan is to go in and to remix both of the Christmas albums. There's no need to re-record all the orchestration because the orchestras for the Christmas tracks were much larger than a standard Carpenters recording. So and the bulk of all the arranging was done by the great Billy May and Peter Knight. So Richard didn't see any reason in going in and tinkering with that. What the plan is to go in and clean up the background noise and that kind of thing, bring Karen's leads up in the mix, kind of like he did with Royal Philharmonic. The Christmas Portrait album was remixed in its entirety, with the exception of Merry Christmas, Darling, in 1990. Engineer Roger Young and Richard went in and did this. And one of the complaints that a lot of people have with that is that there's an overuse of reverb, particularly on Karen's vocals. Richard was talked into this, he claims, by Roger Young. And at that time, that was, you know, I don't know if it was just a matter of a shimmer or polish that he wanted to put on that. And of course, the tracks all needed to be brightened up a little from the original mixes. But looking back, you know, Richard says, you know, vocals, you know, you put reverb on vocals like that really need that kind of help on a lead. Karen didn't need that. So, you know, when his intention is to correct that issue as well, and that sort of thing. So I don't know whether, I know that the project is still active with Universal. I can't say for certain whether it's we're going to see it this year. Hopefully we'll see it this year. Fingers crossed. But that is the answer, hopefully, to that question. So the third question, somebody writes, what was Karen's favorite Christmas song from the album? So Richard said Karen's favorite song, as far as the vocal performance is concerned, is Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. She was also, as was he, very fond of Christ Is Born and Little Altar Boy. So those were the favorites. Of course, Little Altar Boy, there was not enough room on the Portrait album to include it. And so when Richard put out the second Christmas album in 1984, he included that in there. I'm certainly glad he did. That's just a beautiful, beautiful reading by Karen. So, but yes, her favorite was Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, to answer your question. The next question, somebody writes in, being that O Holy Night is Richard's favorite Christmas song, I would think that there must be a Karen vocal recorded someplace in the archives. The answer to that is no. They did record the song that was intended to go on the Christmas Portrait album. Again, they did a lot of over-recording, and I'll get into why in a minute. All they got out of that was the track, because, in other words, Karen never recorded a master lead. The reason for that was because they had so much that they were recording and so much to get finished, and just with everything that was going on, and it was just an incredible production and very expensive, of course, to produce. It was a toss-up between O Holy Night and Christ Is Born, and Christ Is Born is the one that went out. So she never, you know, she wasn't going to waste her time recording a master lead on a song that wasn't going to make it on an album anyway. Incidentally, in 84, when Richard put out an old-fashioned Christmas album, there's a piano solo rendition of O Holy Night. The orchestral track that he is playing over the top of is the track that was recorded for Karen. So we don't hear Karen, but we do hear the rest of the orchestration that was laid down in 78. And that was the story with that. The next question, somebody asked, Chris, could you provide some clarification on this comment from Karen's 1978 KIQQ Christmas Portrait interview regarding the Ave Maria? She says they had them both cut, and she's quoted as saying, the Ave Maria, we were going back and forth between the Bach Linode version and Schubert, and we had them both cut. When it came down to the last choice, we didn't have any more time to cut the other one. Richard felt that, you know, he wanted to go with the Bach version. So it sounds a little contradictory. It's actually not. What she was saying there is that they recorded the track to both. She never got around to recording the track again for the same reason as O Holy Night. Once it was decided that the Bach version was the version that was going to go on the record, she didn't have the time to go in and record the lead on the Schubert. So it never got done. Yes, it was recorded as far as the track, you know, the orchestration was written and recorded, but Karen never completed a lead on that. Next question, and this one really kind of sets up the rest of my talking points, and I've sort of reworded this a little bit just for readability, but this person writes, was there much promotion on the Christmas Portrait album? Having worked in the radio business at the time, I had a lot of knowledge as to the music industry's goings-on, but was surprised when I was gifted the album at the time of the release. The answer is no. They didn't do a lot of promotion. And the first reason for that, I'll get into how the Christmas Portrait album came to be. But the executives at A&M made it very clear pretty much throughout the decade of the 70s that the artists were not to record Christmas albums. They did not want, you know, Herb put out his album with the TJB, the Tijuana Brass, in 68, Christmas album. After that, there really wasn't much coming out of A&M in the way of Christmas. And again, Richard says that A&M was, you know, no Christmas music. The way they got around this was actually related to their relationship with ABC and the television specials. And I want to talk about that. So I'm going to put Christmas on hold for just a second. We're going to go back to 1976. They had their first television special with ABC. It was called The Carpenters' Very First Television Special. And I want to say it came in at 6 or 7 on the Nielsen ratings. And it did fairly well. And so right away they were offered another special. Now, Karen and Richard had wanted to do a Christmas album for years. You know, Richard said Karen was clearly born to sing Christmas music, and she was. So they and their now manager, Jerry Weintraub, they were no longer at this point with B&B, with Sherwin Bash. Now it's Jerry and Management 3. They were having a discussion. Richard doesn't recall who came up with the idea, but they all agreed that their second special, their follow-up, needed to be a Christmas special. And so Billy May, the great arranger, who was Sony, you know, it was announced, Sony music director Billy May, you know, was going to be the handling the, you know, the directing, music directing duties on this special. So he was responsible for writing the arrangements, which is why you have a handful of songs on the Christmas Portrait album that were arranged by Billy May, because they were songs that were recorded in 77 for the first special, I believe it's Carpenter, The Carpenters at Christmas. And so Jerry Weintraub, in his wisdom, you know, shortly thereafter, in another meeting at his office, said, you know, ABC is paying me and the Carpenters a whole lot of money to bring all of these musicians in, because all of this was pre-taped. Every one of their specials, the music was always pre-recorded. They did it at A&M in Studio D. And so, you know, they had massive budgets for these orchestras. It was a, you know, 60 piece, and you had a choir and everything else. And so Jerry made the point that they're paying us all of this money in a budget to bring in all of these musicians for something that, you know, these shows were not in syndication after. I mean, they were played one time, you know, out of a speaker this big, you know, on a on the television set. And he said, well, why not use this to kick off a Christmas album? You know, we can take these recordings, we can do more. So I think in you know, short order, A&M agreed to that. And so they continued through December of 77 into January, February of 78. Richard brought in a different arranger orchestrator, and that is UK's Peter Knight. Peter was with the Moody Blues. Richard had an album called The Days of Future Past that was released in 1967, and it featured Peter's orchestrations. And Richard, that always stuck with him from that album. In 1971, the Carpenters went over to London to play the to do their show for the BBC, their live at the BBC. And coming out of their studio, they saw Peter was coming out of the studio next door, an orchestration and a scoring room. And somebody said, "Oh, Richard and Karen Carpenter, meet Peter Knight." And Richard says, "The Peter Knight?" And Richard laughs about this when he tells the story, but Peter said, "Well, my boy is the Peter Knight, his son. But yeah, I'm Peter, nice to meet you." And of course, you know, most people wouldn't have known who Peter was, but of course, Richard, you know, knew him from this album and greatly admired his work. So 3 years later, when Karen and Richard went over to Europe in 74, prior to that, Richard reached out to Peter to see if he would be interested in writing the overture for their upcoming performance with the Boston Pops, which took place, I believe, sometime around July. So Peter agreed to that. And then when Karen and Richard flew over to Europe in 74, Peter gave him the arrangement, looked it over, you know, read it down, loved it, was great. And so that was really the start of that relationship, working relationship with Peter. And that orchestra, or that overture, is also incorporated in the overture that we hear on the Royal Philharmonic album from 2018. Richard did some additional writing in that, but that was all sort of stemmed from Peter's overture for the Boston Pops. But so Richard felt that, you know, Peter was an obvious choice to come in and write the arrangements. Now, the Carpenters, as I said, had wanted to do a Christmas album for a long time, but what Richard had envisioned was something that was more along the lines of songs like Merry Christmas, Darling. Even if they were covers of other songs, you know, it would be a matter of him finding songs that really, you know, where he could incorporate the formula, you know, so to speak, the overdubbed vocals, he and Karen, and not so much of the choir and all of that. He was in really bad shape with his drug addiction, Quaalude addiction by this point, and had zero motivation to do any of this stuff. And so it was one of those things that once Peter signed on, you know, they were picking songs and Richard said, "Oh, well, I'll give this one to Peter. Oh, I'll give that one to Peter." That was the reason that they over-recorded for the album, because Peter was very fast and he could, you know, turn this stuff out. And so they, you know, they went over budget, they over-recorded, they had a whole bunch because, again, Richard was relying on Peter for that. But that's and they were initially going for the Spike Jones and the City Slickers kind of vibe from their Christmas album that the Carpenters had grown up with. Richard now regrets having done so much of that. There's other, you know, he wishes, Karen, that he would have thought to record songs like Blue Christmas, you know, the Elvis Presley hit. That would have been a perfect, you know, in a country-esque kind of flair, would have been a perfect one for Karen. But Richard said, "I just wasn't thinking about this kind of stuff. I was just in a different state of mind with that." So that's the story there. So then in 78, they had the next Christmas special. And of course, Christmas Portrait came out, the album. The special was called A Christmas Portrait. And that one actually featured a cameo. Gene Kelly was in that, appeared on that as the guest. And the Carpenters' parents, Mom and Dad Carpenter, came in and did a cameo. And I'll let you hear in Richard's words from an interview that Mike and I did in Richard when we were sitting down doing the extensive interview on just specifically Christmas back in early 2021. This is Richard talking a little bit about that.
It was one of my things when, whether it be Andy Williams or whoever it was, had to have parents. So we're in Weintraub's office and discussing the latest special. It's going to be another Christmas special. But then Karen says, "Oh, and I want to have, you know, my folks on it." I said, "Karen." And Weintraub's going, no, you know, not our parents, just the whole thing. "No parents on the..." I said, "Karen, come on. Please don't do this." You know, when Karen had her mind made up on something, so that was that. And it was fine, and Dad was great, because he had this droll sense. So what Gene says something the way to Mom, as far as the way when he met her, and And Dad delivered whatever line it was. And of course, the set cracked up because it was delivered so well. And originally, it was, there was meant to be a musical segment, mm-hmm. which was good because it's the only time that Mom ever was dragged into a recording studio and sang, oh, won't you play a simple melody? Mm-hmm. And the first note,
she sounds like
Karen.
Yes.
Won't you play a simple melody like my mother sang to me?
But Mom, of course, didn't have, especially at that age, but probably what it takes to read, because she kept going and she knows these songs by heart. Mm-hmm. Someone is born with the gift to be able not just sing but to record and hear a track come in, and not that she couldn't have learned with some practice, but mm-hmm. Interesting. But just to hear her sing those first couple of notes.
Yeah.
It truly is remarkable just how much Mom Carpenter and Karen resembled each other, particularly on that low F coming in. It's quite amazing. But just to finish answering that last question about the Christmas Portrait album and promotion, no, there was very little to no promotion done. Dad Carpenter, Harold, walked into the local Gemco right after the album dropped and was looking all over for it and asked a manager, hey, do you have a copy of the Carpenter's Christmas Portrait? And there wasn't a single copy to be found. And of course, he was livid. But, you know, Richard says, and he maintains this view to this day, that the success of an album, of a record, a single, a song, an album, whatever, is in the grooves. In other words, you know, if you don't do any promotion or touring to promote something, if something is good and somebody hears it on the radio, they're going to pick up on it and it's going to be a success, whether you think it's going to be or not. And on the contrary, you know, you can do all the promotion in the world, and if it's just not jiving with the audience, then, you know, it can be a total flop. So definitely something to consider when you look at the longevity and the success of the Carpenters. You know, they had to put up with a lot of that with the label and promotions and things not being properly marketed in terms of their image and their album covers. That's another whole story. We get into that in depth in the legacy book as well. So I wanted to move on to a little bit of trivia before I finish up. And I didn't want to skip over 1974 because that's where we get the second Carpenters Christmas single, Santa Claus is Coming to Town. It was recorded for the Perry Como Christmas special. And as a side note, Richard said that was one of two times that Karen was ever nervous singing in front of anybody. The first was for President Nixon at the White House 2 years earlier, and the second was Perry Como. They were huge fans growing up of Perry's music. Richard was particularly influenced, and so it was quite an honor to be working alongside him. And Karen was nervous, apparently, but you know, that was also pre-recorded. All of their parts for that special, the Carpenters I'm talking about, was pre-recorded. Perry sang live, and Karen knocked out that lead vocal in the first take. She went out and sang it down, and it was perfect. She didn't need to re-sing it in Studio A, Richard recalls, said it was just remarkable. And that recording was another oversight, something that he didn't even think about for the Christmas Portrait album, again, because of the state of mind that he was in. He never thought to include it, and so he put it out in 84 on an old-fashioned Christmas album, gave it a remix, updated the sax solo. Bob Messenger played the solo on the single mix in 74. And as another note of trivia, in the harmony stack, there was a third harmonic that they had inadvertently not left out of the recording when they recorded it in 84, or I'm sorry, 74. So Richard added that third part in and double-tracked it for the before mixing it in 84 to complete the harmony, to get that all the way that he wanted it, the way it was intended to be. So moving on, Christmas Portrait opens with O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. Now that was supposed to, again, it's Richard a cappella. He's just singing with himself, double-tracked, unison. That was meant to have the same treatment as It Came Upon a Midnight Clear, which opens the second Christmas album, which is 8 up to 9 part harmony double track, 18 voices. Richard again just didn't have the motivation to complete it and to write the or to you know create the vocal arrangement. It would have been he and Karen. So we just get the single lead by Richard. Incidentally, there are two mixes. There's the original mix from 78 and the remix from 1990, which has appeared on all the subsequent releases of Christmas Portrait. As I mentioned, that entire album was remixed. And there's an alternate vocal by Richard, and a lot of people don't catch this. On one, he sings, "And captive, and ransom captive Israel." And the second is "Shall ransom captive Israel." So it's he uses an alternate take on the remix. But you know, if you have both recordings, you might want to listen to that. And just it's just something to take note of. And regarding "It Came Upon a Midnight Clear," Richard. So that was a as I said, it got up to 9 parts in a couple of places. Richard was in Studio D in the booth, vocal booth, overdubbing. Roger Young was the engineer. And when it got to the section. To touch their harps of gold, Richard, just winging it, started overdubbing all of his vocals and sang the wrong lyric. He sang, "To touch their hearts of gold." And they were on a smoke break, and Roger, I don't remember if Richard mentioned he happened to glance at the lead sheet or a lyric sheet or something, and he said, "Richard, I think this is wrong. It's actually harps." So, of course, you know, Richard had to go back and repunch that... You know that I think it comes up twice in the toward the end that word, and so he had to redo that, and just you know, a minor blunder there. Sleigh Ride, that one. There are a couple of notes of trivia on that. Bob Messenger, who normally was heard on the studio recordings either playing sax or flute, actually sang on I believe it's the bridge. There's the line, "There's a Christmas party at the home of Farmer Gray." That's Bob singing. He has a very sort of breathy, almost whimsical kind of sounding voice. The next line is bandmate Doug Strawn. And then the third line is Bob, Doug, and Richard all together singing. I was blessed and had the fortune to do a full recorded interview with Bob in 2016. I believe it's the only interview on record that he's done. And we talked about, I wanted to ask him about this when we were covering his career. I'll let you hear a little excerpt of that, but it was, he thought it was a bit of a silly bit and kind of a prank, but went along with it. And I'll let you listen to Bob tell the story.
The Christmas album, the Christmas Portrait, all that stuff was recorded 77, 78, because you guys had a couple of television specials, the Carpenters at Christmas, and then you had the Christmas Portrait special the following year in 78.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
You actually sang on Sleigh Ride.
Yeah, I know.
Now,
I thought Richard had a great sense of humor, you know, because I never sang at all.
You have such a recognizable voice, and it is perfect. I mean, how did you get roped into that one?
Why don't Richard get us? Richard said, "Go on, do that. You can do that." You know, so I did it. You know, it was just like a gag. You know, I thought.
And yeah, well,
yeah, it came out. I mean, the way it came out was all right, but I have no voice whatsoever.
There's a Christmas party at the home of Farmer Gray. It'll be the perfect ending of a perfect day.
It's funny because it's a great part. I think you sing it, and then Doug sings the next line,
and then the three of group, yeah.
And then Richard, right? I think the three of you guys all did the third part.
Uh-huh.
There's a happy feeling nothing in the world can buy. As they pass around the coffee and the pumpkin pie, it'll nearly be like a picture print by Korea.
Just after that section in the song, there's the... line, "These wonderful things are the things we remember all through our lives." And the melody is a bit of an obstacle course, tonally speaking. And a lot of artists sort of cheat when they sing it, you know. "These wonderful things are the things we remember all..." You know, they just kind of jump the octave. They don't really... And Karen, when she got to that part and was singing it, and they were about to track it with, you know, the lead, she said, I don't know if I can sing it. And Richard said, "Well, what do you... Okay, I'm sure you can do it." She says, it's too rangy. It's too big. Billy May wrote on her chart, and There's a copy of it in the book. When it gets to that part, Karen, take it, baby. And Richard, again, said she, the first take, right out the gate, she nailed it. And that's the take that we hear. So quite impressive, but not surprising. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. That was the closer on An Old-Fashioned Christmas. One that everybody involved regretted even recording. Richard decided to put it out and then regrets. This is one that he had a big regret with. Because not that Karen didn't sound beautiful on it, but it was vibrato all the way through. And that wasn't Karen's style. Even engineer Ray Gerhardt, who was a man of very few words, even said, this one will never see the light of day. I mean, he even made a comment about it. So nobody thought it was going to make it out. And that was one of Richard's regrets, having included it later on that second album. And then I just wanted to talk real briefly about the Bruce Forsyth special. That was, for those that are familiar with it, that is the Christmas special in December of 78. Karen went over to the UK by herself. Richard was just weeks away from going into rehab finally to deal with his addiction to Quaaludes. So he was in no shape to be traveling internationally. And so Karen went over there. She thought she was going over to promote the Christmas Portrait album. And as Richard says, that was the last thing that A&M cared about. It was actually a bit of a setup. She got over there and they were promoting the singles 1974 to 78. They had just released that album a few weeks earlier, in November. And Richard says anytime that A&M UK was in trouble, they would put out another Carpenter's Hits album. So she got over there, and of course, Richard wasn't there. Peter Knight was helping out with the orchestrations and whatnot on the Christmas stuff. But now, that's why Please Mr. Postman and I Need to Be in Love are included in that performance in this Christmas show, because she got sort of caught up in the promotions at the last minute with that. And she, Richard says that for whatever reason, he thinks, he recalls it had something to do with union rules. Anytime you were either going to lip sync or sing live to a pre-recorded track, the track had to be recorded in the UK if you were going to use it for broadcast on UK on television. So Karen went into the studio with the touring band, the guys that were over there with her, and produced that whole recording. And of course, she had the original, as a roadmap. But Richard, to this day, says, it was absolutely remarkable. Not only that she went over and did what she did as well as she did, but then she owned it, and she went in and reproduced a recording. Instrumentally and backing vocals, because Karen is heard in those backing vocal parts. She's singing live, of course, but that whole instrumental, that's a track that the band is just playing, just sort of mocking to. So anyway, that's the story with that, and I think that wraps it up. So if any of you have any questions, I am on aandmcorner.com in the Carpenters Forum. You can send me a private message. And I get people, write in all the time with various questions, Q&A, for the Q&A on the Carpenters, so I'm happy to answer those. In the meantime, try to stay cool, and until next time, be safe and be blessed. Merry, merry, merry.